everybody, and welcome to another episode of Radiorama, where I show you, as the name implies, how to work on radios, and sometimes televisions, stereos, record players, just about anything that runs on glowing vacuum tubes from the 1930s through the 1960s or thereabouts. And I apologize because my loud washing machine is about to go into the spin cycle. But we have a Remler. There's no model number that I can see. I'll probably have to take the chassis out before I can identify it. A Remler is a local manufacturer, at least for here. They were based out of San Francisco, and I believe some version of the company existed right up through the 80s. They quit making consumer sets and went into commercial communications. I think they went into the aerospace. Avionics is what I believe they went into. I don't know if it works because the cord has been cut, and I'm not sure what I'm going to see. The chassis fits in from the bottom, which is kind of unusual. The case, the finish is a little tired, but I think we can rejuvenate it a little bit with some furniture products. The knobs are held in with set screws. I'm really hoping it's not a hot chassis set. My experience with Remler is that they built them right. Most of them actually had a power transformer. A lot of the radio manufacturers were real keen on going to a floating hot chassis design because it was cheaper. Anyway, spin cycle's about to start, so let me take the chassis out. Okay, so this is what the chassis looks like, and it's unusual because we have what appears to be a transformerless set, but we have a field coil speaker. I can't think of the last time I've seen a floating hot chassis set that had a field coil speaker in it. We'll have a 5-tube design, clearly marked tube locations. We have a 5OL6 output, 35Z5 rectifier. We have a triode here, 12SK or 12SQ7, 12SK7. 12SA7, very typical. We have a two gain tuning condenser. It's almost got like a homemade kind of quality going on. No model number anywhere. This is just a licensing information for licensing from RCA. Kind of like this weird frame that they've built here. So let me pull the bottom off and we'll take a look underneath to see what we're up against here. All right, well, nothing too amazing underneath here. We have had a brain fart. I was like, why is there an output transformer when it's a field coil? Like, duh, it has to have an output transformer. Anyway, not much to write home about. We have the electrolytic. Two values here. It's a 20 plus 20 microfarad cap, probably rated at 150 volts, which makes sense. Hot chassis set, can't any more than 120 volts going in. And we have some things going to ground that I'm not wild about. We have this time period, this is probably a post-war set. I'm guessing this is between 46, 47, somewhere around there. You'd have these sets where they would ground the grids of some of the IF and RF tubes. So 12S A7, K7, Q7 probably all have their grids to ground, which means that once I get it recapped, it'll probably initially fail my safety test. This, I believe, is the other end of the AC line that's going to chassis ground. Way too big of a value. This is too big of a value as well. We need to replace that with something safer. Essentially, what these are doing is they're going to allow too much current to get to the chassis. It's not a true hot chassis set. If it was a true hot chassis, you'd have one end of the AC line going to chassis ground. Granted, this one is not that easy to get at because the chassis is completely inside a wooden box and the knobs are held on with set screws. So someone would really, really have to try to touch something metal and ground at the same time. The cord obviously needs to be replaced because it's non-existent. But I usually start with my electrolytics and my safety caps before giving it a test to see if it's got any life. I get the feeling it actually might work because I noticed this International Service Master tube in there, and that's a pretty late addition. I believe Service Master, what they did is they'd buy up surplus tubes from other manufacturers and slap their name on it. At least that's what I was told. I'm not sure if that's actually true. You can also sometimes mitigate the problems of having a grounded grid on some of these tubes by changing out the metal tubes with the glass tube. Don't ask me why. Maybe it's because there's less chance for conductivity being a metal tube versus glass, but it usually works. But enough with that. What I'm going to do is replace this electrolytic that has two values with two separate electrolytic capacitors. I don't have any 20 microfarad caps. I'll just put some 40s in there. It'll be fine. As long as your capacitance level or rating is at or greater, don't go crazy. It'll be fine. The worst that'll happen is if you put a huge value in there, that can stress out your rectifier tube a little bit, but tubes can usually take quite a bit of beating, so it doesn't concern me much. And plus 3.5Z5s, there's like 10,000 million of those out floating around. But 40 will be just fine. No harm done. Okay, so I've done the bare minimum here. We have two new electrolytics and the oh-so-important two-ground safety cap. Now, I'm going to go ahead and go for broke and see if this has any life to it. I've been waiting for my stupid washing machine to spin down, which it's finally done. So that's, whoa, pilot light is acting funny. Hope I just didn't lose filament. That's a terrible sound. I am noticing, though, there's a lot of corrosion on my tube pins. So I think what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna spray those down and wiggle the tubes. Set this upright, see if there's some issue going on with the antenna. Just do some very basic stuff here. If it still doesn't work, the next easiest thing to do, logically, is to start testing some tubes. A lot of people will, for some reason, insist on trying to diagnose something without doing the basics first. I'm looking at this resistor here. It's weird. It's got goo all over it. But this is probably going to filament. If that were open, it wouldn't work, period. All right, let me spray these. Yeah, you see all that corrosion on there? I'm gonna spray it with a contact cleaner and wiggle the tubes. All right, let's try this again. I cleaned all those contacts. And okay, I can see filament on the rectifier and output tube. That's good. Nothing. Got audio. Audio section's fine. It's time to get out my tube tester. I believe one of these guys could be bad. One of these three. 12SA7, 12SQ7, 12SK7. Alright. I know it sounds stupid, but sometimes people will put the tubes in the wrong sockets. So that's a good thing to check for as well. Correct tube. What are you? Oh shit, a writing came off. 12SK7, yes, that's correct. Whoa! Almost rolled off the bench there. And let's make sure this is 12SA7. Are you 12SA7? Yes. And the rectifier and output tubes, clearly in the right sockets. Time to get up the old trusty tube tester and see what's going on. Well, the 50L6 output tube, it's weird. I think it might have been on its way out, and it just, I didn't even get a chance to test it. It briefly glowed, and then I lost filament entirely. You can see it's not registering. Wait a minute. Yeah, it's not registering at all. So, let me just double check here. What is the selection D? Line adjust. Let's see. It's hosed. Well, that's a problem. I'm not sure why it caused reception issues. I mean, it seemed like it was working in the set, but it could have been shorting, which could screw some things up, but I'll never know because I can't test the tube. So let me get another 50L6. The rest of these guys tested perfectly good. So it's not tubes. So if it doesn't work, there's something else going on here. Hope it's not silver mica disease, even though you'd hear consistent crackling up and down the line if it was silver mica disease. And I don't think this era is as prone. I don't know. I'm blowing smoke out of my ass, whatever. Well, my quote-unquote replacement tube is not good either. It's very weak. It was shoved in this box. Usually what I find is that if you get damn, I think that thing is hot plating. Those sides are super hot. Let me get another one. Okay, so I replaced the output tube. And what I got, as soon as it warmed up, was my pilot lamp flashed. Basically, it burnt open. And I'm not sure what the technical reason is for this. I've had this happen in the past, where even though your rectifier tube 35Z5 will test fine and not show any shorts, it in fact can still be shorted and not show up on the tube tester. And that in turn will cause your pilot lamp to do that. So I suspect this tube is actually bad, even though it tests good. So I'm going to go get another rectifier and replace the pilot lamp and see what happens. I've also noticed there's a bunch of insulation that's kind of been gnawed off of the antenna. I think I've got some other antenna loops, so if I might try that. The other thing, too, is I've still got a bunch of original old caps in there. There could very well be a cap that is shorted. So it's stupid, me doing this, without at least replacing the rest of the capacitors in there, of which there's not. So I'm talking to myself, asking myself, why am I not doing the obvious? Good question. Who knows? Just because I'm a glutton for punishment, let's see if I'm going to sacrifice another pilot light again. If I do, then I know it's not the output tube. It's probably a shorted capacitor. Whoa! Yep, that immediately blew the pilot lamp. Let's see, if I still have filament at all? I can't even tell. Because both of these guys, I can't see the filaments. It is warming up. Maybe, I don't know. Well, fudge. I wonder if that rectifier that I put in there was any good. This is stupid. I put the tube tester away even. Okay, well, I tested just the first cap. Whoops. What's that all about? I'll try this again. Testing. That cap is measuring as a resistor. That means that's fused together. That's no good. So, I'm going to quit being lazy. I've got four caps to replace here. And having a fused together cap is a great way to have your radio not work. So I'm going to quit wasting my pilot lights and just do what I should have done. Common sense thing. And see if that makes an improvement. If not, it's going to be time to go into diagnostic mode. Can't be that much going wrong here. I hope that I don't have a problem with one of these IF transformers. But basically, the radio is dead. Completely dead. We got audio, but no radio. All right, everything's replaced except for this guy. I'm not too concerned about that. There's not really any voltage or current on that to speak of, so it's not going to cause anything to go haywire. I need to dig through my supplies to see if I have another one of those. That's a 500 puff, and I think I have some ceramic caps that are of that ilk. So without further ado, and I tested this guy out of circuit when I took it out. It's fused together, completely hosed. So I could see why that would possibly cause the pilot lamp to completely blow open like that. Because essentially it's causing a huge inrush of current. Essentially, probably, potentially, initially 110 volts hitting that thing. So I'm brave, I put another pilot lamp in there, and I'm going to watch to see when I turn it on if it's going to blow. No, that's an improvement. I'm just going to keep my eye on it. If it pops, then we've still got some problems here. But it's not. It seems like it's holding steady. Wants to pick up. It's horrific reception. So either indeed the antenna's messed up or it's just thrown out of alignment. I actually recently had a few sets that came in where the alignment was just hilariously off. So let me flip it up and see if I can tweak that and it makes any improvement. So first of all, we have a lot of contact happening in this tuning condenser. It's like they're complete. There's a lot of touching going on, which is probably killing my signal. And it's across the board. Except right there. That's not too bad. So I need to clean these fins out and maybe bend them out, bend them a little bit outward so they're not rubbing. Okay, that's an improvement. I was able to clean these fins out. I used a little strip of business card. You just want to run it down. Just like that. That'll clean it out. Still got some dirt in there though. Wish I had a can of air somewhere. That's freaking annoying. Still got some work to do. Let's see here. Come on, commercial. Well, I need to clean these out. I can't really get it to stay on a station reliably. There's just too much contact happening in that tuning condenser. Okay, I've managed to successfully clean the fins on the tuning condenser. It seems like we're picking up channels all across the board. Now, there's a couple things happening that I'm not wild about. Number one, because I have replaced the original two chassis ground cap with a much lower value, it's causing my radio audio to be slightly distorted. I'm a little bit concerned also because when I took this over to test it on the bench over there, it failed spectacularly. That means that probably the pin number one of 12SA7 is causing it to fail. So that means that if I clip the lead coming off of the grid of 12SA7 and the radio performance is already marginal, it's just going to make it a lot worse. So I'm not sure what to do about this. It could be that radio will be compromised. It'll still be usable, but slightly compromised as far as sound quality. And I'll just have to trust the fact that most of the people that get these things don't really listen to AM. I know it's lame, but they'll listen to their music through it. I'd like to make a compromise here. I'd like radio to still work decently, but it also needs to be safer. We have a standard where we don't want more than a certain amount of current getting from chassis, you know, to ground. So I'm going to start doing some experiments here to see if I can improve things. Okay, it still actually kind of works after clipping the lead from 12SA7. The next thing I'm going to do is see if I have any glass tube equivalents. Why does the backup alarms on trucks sound so weird today? I guess it makes you pay attention. Okay, well, I kept on clipping leads, and clipping the grid off of 12SK7 killed my radio entirely. Even though it's kind of a fun sound. But what I'll need to do is put a cap between that and ground. What I want to do is take it over and test it on my safety rig to see if we've crossed the safety threshold. This one is a very on the edge set as far as working radio with my lowering of the capacitors. It seems like it was designed very much to want to have a much higher to ground cap. It's an obvious statement. Sometimes you can stick these much smaller value caps in there and it doesn't matter. It'll work fine. This one seems to be unhappy with that, so we're gonna need to make some concessions. All right, well, it now passes safety just barely. Not just barely, I've got about 0.2 volts off of our scale. Our scale is 2 volts AC, maximum threshold is 0.6 volts with a output of 250 millivolts, sorry. Let's test the other side. That's probably the neutral side. Yep, that's the neutral side. So I need to bring back radio because right now radio doesn't do shit. And I think I'm going to... Sometimes I find that if I get a 0.0047 cap between the grid of 12SK7 and the chassis, that'll generally work. That's been my experience. I could be wrong, though. Okay, so now it's meeting safety, but the radio audio is just not great. I'm going to cheat a little bit and add a second one of these caps in here. You can see that makes just a little bit of an improvement, just a tiny amount. It's aggravating. Anyway, let me put another cap in there and then we'll see how that does. That's actually not too bad. Speaking of Thursday night football, in week 2, Nick in yards and
hbnshow.com. We can go weeks without food and days without water, but oxygen is so crucial that we can only survive minutes without it. Oxygen.
Well, I'll be darned. I didn't know that. I thought you could just like survive forever without oxygen. I have a little bit of a confession to make. This was actually not making a good contact to the chassis. I'm going to go over and do one more safety check to make sure that we're still on board with meeting our requirements. And then, since the radio itself is up and running and happy again, first of all, I'll replace that last cap. And then I will shift my attention to the cabinet, which needs a little bit of tender, loving care. Okay, so we're firing on mostly all cylinders now. I'm pretty happy with the radio quality. I'm going to do a little bit of final tweaking on the IF cans.
Nova Scotia Premier Tim Houston.
The priority right now is getting power back to people, getting people a safe shelter, getting, you know, some return to normal. That will take time.
The Fed raised interest rates again last week, and on CBS, President of the Federal Reserve Bank of Atlanta was asked why inflation hasn't gone down yet.
I actually think that there is some ability for the economy to absorb our actions and slow in a relatively orderly way. But we need to have slow.
I took a look at schools, hospitals.
Okay, that's mostly there. I'm going to actually hook it up to my oscilloscope, or my, not oscilloscope, my signal generator, just to make sure we really dial it in. It's doing pretty good now. It's certainly much improved. And on top of that, we have our nice safety factor. We got the amount of current dropped down to a safer level. So I'm pretty happy with that. So now it's time to turn my attention to the case. Okay, now it's time to work on the case. I'm going to use my favorite product. It's called Old English. It's been around for a million years. And it's this stuff. I'm not sure what it's made out of. But you put it on, you start wiping it on, and what it does, it helps disappear a lot of the cracks. Not cracks, the blemishes and imperfections that are in the finish. You can see how this is already looking a lot better. I have to get something to get down these little cracks. But just want to go over the whole thing with it. I put it on pretty liberally and then I let it kind of soak in for a while. I'm going to go over the whole case with this. That's one step. We'll need to follow a few other steps, including either beeswax or car wax. We want to be able to bring back the gloss of this finish, as it was a glossy finish when it was new. Okay, so this is wet. This is not the way it's going to look when it's done, but what I wanted to do was just soak the entire finish with Old English. I'm going to let it sit here for a few hours. In fact, I've decided it's a lazy Sunday. It's time to clean up the old pickup truck, maybe give it a wax job. And by then, it'll be time to move on to the second application of finish restoration stuff on this. All right, so the truck's done. And, you know, this is proof that I'm very obsessive compulsive, which is why would anyone spend this amount of time cleaning an engine in a 27-year-old Econo car or Econo truck or whatever. But I did. I even cleaned underneath the wheel wells. Got new tires recently because the old ones were dry rotten. And did the interior. Starting to look a little bit worn and rough in there, but, you know, it's getting old. So, now that we've done the truck and let the stuff dry on the radio, it's time to take a look and see how much of that absorbed. Looks like it absorbed pretty well. It's time to bring out the Caranuba car wax to bring back some shine. It's perfect because it's warm and hot out here. So we want that wax to really penetrate and kind of get into that finish. Also clean some of the grime and dirt that has accumulated over the years. So, I have about an hour, then I'm supposed to go meet with my brother, his wife, and 10-month-old baby. I'm trying to be a better uncle, so I want the baby to have kind thoughts about good old Uncle Seth, even though he's probably crazy and works on old radios. Anyway, let me get this out here in the sun and do some polishing. All right, it's time to wax the cabinet, and so I'm going to use an old-fashioned Carnauba paste wax. I don't like the liquid. I mean, the liquid stuff's great for cars and stuff, and also if you have a radio that has a much finer finish on it that's in better shape, fine. But I feel like the paste wax really does a better job of kind of like stripping all the grime and dirt and also bringing back that luster. You see there's like a lot of filth that's coming up with this wreck. This is hot out here. I think I need to put this inside to do this. I'm like burning up. But you get the idea. We're going to go over the whole thing with paste wax several times, and slowly the original shine will come back. Okay, so I have succeeded in waxing this cabinet. It's looking a lot better. As I was working on it, I noticed that there was a part of the back of the cabinet that was coming apart. I noticed it was kind of making this creaking noise when I was cleaning it. And this seam is coming apart. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to get some wood glue, and then I'm going to put some glue down in there, and I'm going to put probably a cloth and then a weight on top of it to make sure it's going to stick back. Actually, my brother gave me some clamps. I forgot. He gave me some like big-ass clamps. So I might as well put those to good use. All right, so the next stage, since we have, well, let me back up just a minute. First of all, I did spend some quality time waxing this case. I also had a break in the back, and I glued that back together again. And so now it's time to do the audio input feature that I add to all of these sets. Well, not all of them. If there's an historically significant set, I won't do it. Or if it's mine, like if it's my radio, and I know it's just going to be eye candy, I won't do it. But for most of these, they're going to go to people who are not necessarily radio collectors, but they want to use them so that they can actually listen to music versus the non-existent programming that's on AM these days, as in like no music. Maybe you live in a jurisdiction where there's still music on AM, but around here there's nothing. If you like sports or talk radio, sure. Or religious stuff, sure. Then you know, all you need to do is turn on the radio. But if you want to listen to anything else, then especially if you don't want to hear that annoying Cars for Kids commercials, well, this is how you do it. I'm not going to go into tremendous detail on this one because I've detailed this in every other video. But what we're going to do essentially is come in with audio via the secondary side of an isolation transformer. The winding is 120 volts in and 12 volts out. You can do 6 volts out as well. If you're in another country where it's 220, same deal. 220 in, 12, 6, whatever volts out. This is the primary. This is where the high voltage goes in. And so this goes to either side of the volume control. And before I do that, I also need to confirm which one of these leads is the incoming radio signal. And I looked at it and determined that this is the negative side. This is the incoming positive side. You can see this wire is going up into the bottom of that IF transformer. So that should be the radio signal. I'll clip this and bring it back on and see if we have effectively killed the radio signal. And then we will add a switch. And that switch will come out the back. And it's going to be tricky on this one since it goes up into the cabinet. I'll probably make a little hidden switch underneath somewhere because I don't want to drill through the wooden case because that would be kind of lame. And that way, the user, if they decide, yes, I want to listen to actual AM radio, they can. And at the same time, if they want to listen to their Bluetooth or whatever it is they happen to be plugging into their little cord, then they can turn the radio off so it doesn't pollute the signal or pollute the audio. So I'll go ahead and do that, and when I get done, I'll show you what that looks like. All right, I accidentally forgot to film that last part. I just got carried away, but anyway, it's all put back together again. What I did, because of the way this is constructed, I put a switch hidden back here so that it can sit like this. Anyway, got my Bluetooth running through it. It's probably about as good as you're going to get out of a little 4.5-inch speaker, but you know, it is what it is. That's what people listened to back in the 40s. Anyway, I'm going to let it run for a little bit longer. I want to make sure that whatever heat is generated, once it's inside that cabinet, it's not going to cause anything to degrade or go open or whatever. And we'll just call it a day. Anyway, guys, thanks so much for watching. If you have any questions or comments, I'll try to get to them down below. Until the next time radio or something else comes across the workbench, see you guys next time. Adios.